Bismillah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fihi. Wa salawatuhu ta'ala wa salamuhu ala nabihi al-kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Ramadan Mubarak to all of you. And jazakum Allahu khairan for joining me tonight. My name is Imam Marc. I work as the Imam and Religious Director at Middleground, which is located in Upland, California. If you're not familiar, we're a little bit outside of Los Angeles, like right outside the direct LA metro area. So that's usually where I'm stationed. You will hear some kids playing in the background, alhamdulillah, because we're all quarantined and the kids are going crazy. So there's some playing here and you'll hear some kids in the neighborhood. So I had just prepared a few things to kind of direct our session today, talking about the idea of daily gratitude and spiritual fulfillment. These are both topics that I have taught on quite frequently at Middle Ground. And to be quite honest, I always love to kind of, challenge, those in my halakha or in my durus, my classes, in that I don't really know what spirituality is. I don't know if it's a thing. It's such a loosely defined term, but maybe we can investigate that in the few minutes that we're here together today. But most certainly the idea of gratitude, that is something we can certainly grasp firmly onto. So I thought I would actually just relate to us I want to start with a hadith from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is actually something that Ibn al-Qayyim, he relates in his Zad al-Ma'ad, and in which he says, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قال حين يصبح اللهم ما أصبح بي من نعمة أو بأحد من خلقك فمنك. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام says that whoever wakes up in the morning, and if they say, O Allah, whoever, whatever of your favors have come to me, right? Min ni'matin, right? That has either you have given to me to directly, aw bi ahadin min khalqik, or whether it's come by way of one of your creation, faminka, that it is from you. Wahdaka la sharika laka, lakal hamdu wa lakal shukr. And to you belongs all praise, and to you belongs all gratitude. And then he says, likewise, for the one that says, and he says, فَقَدْ أَدَى شُكْرَهُ يَوْمِهِ. He says that if you say that in the morning, then essentially you have fulfilled your necessity for thanking and praising Allah in the morning. And he says, وَمَنْ قَالَ مِثْلَ ذَلِكَ حَيْنَ يُمْسِي. Whoever says that, of course, in the evening, أَدَى شَكْرَ لَيْلَتِهِ, then he has essentially done the same thing. And that does help us to begin the conversation of putting, of at least tackling the daily part of daily gratitude, that it should be something that we do on a daily basis, and that it is something that can be ritualized and it can be a method. And that's often quite helpful, because what I find challenging about things like spirituality is that sometimes they can be a bit loose and they can be not clearly defined. And sometimes it's more about how we feel than about how Allah feels about us. So if we were to try to perhaps work on come up with a working definition of spirituality from the Muslim or the Islamic point of view, it would have to most certainly include that it isn't just about how we feel, but it's recognizing how does Allah feel about us. And expressing gratitude towards Him is certainly something that will, inshallah, make Allah, make Him feel good about us, so to speak. And what we find now, of course, it's amazing how, the clinical sciences are finally kind of catching up and acknowledging the important role that religion and what we would just say deen, of how it plays in our lives, is that, those that not only express gratitude, but feel that they are being grateful, register higher levels of, or you see, better levels of mental health, right? So there is a physiological benefit for us when we express gratitude. And in fact, that gives us kind of like the next rung on the ladder to talk about is, you know, what is it and kind of how it does. I'm going to relate a quote from John Rohn, who is, of course, he's kind of like the godfather of a lot of motivational speakers like Tony Robbins and all those guys. Well, he kind of was like the dude before them that influenced or trained some of them. And he said, give whatever you are doing, right? Give whatever you are doing and whomever you are with the gift of your attention. So an important part for us to understand about how gratitude works is gratitude is very much dependent upon our attention span, right? So we can go and, if we want to break this down a little bit and sort of think of what are the dependencies of shukr. One of the important dependencies of shukr or gratitude is that we have to have focus. We have to be focused on what we are given, as the Prophet said, what? You know, min ni'matin aw bi ahadi min khalqika, whether it's something that Allah gave direct to us or by way of somebody else of His creation. We have to have the focus and the wherewithal to recognize it and therefore pay attention. Also, to be the kind of person that will be like what the Prophet says, what hina yusbihu or hina yumsi, right? Whether it's in the morning or in the evening, we have to have the focus that when I wake up in the morning, it isn't just smash the snooze button, crawl out of bed, you know, outside of Ramadan, make a cup of coffee, pack the kids' lunch, head off to work. This, you know, it requires some focus. So attention is an important dependency of shukr. And if there's one thing that we can certainly say by looking at this hadith and many other ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ on this topic, and of course many of the ayat, many of the verses of the Quran on the subject of shukr, is that, you know, that Allah wants us to have this attention. And when we look at the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, right, when we look at the Sahaba, one reason why they are so venerated and one reason they are so well respected is because if there's one thing that comes across, right, when you read across them, because not all of the companions were quite equal, but you really get the feeling these were people that their attention was focused on Allah, right? And therefore, that's such an admirable quality that we can try to acquire ourselves, which then leads us to, if attention and focus is one of the dependencies of shukr, of gratitude, then what is maybe one of the operational hazards of focus? Well, certainly it's going to be, you know, distraction and those things that lead to distraction. And we live in an age of distraction. There's a quote also here from Harriet Griffey, who's a, I think she lives in the UK. She's a writer and she's written a book on the subject of focus and attention. He says, everyone responds positively to good attention, and in being more attentive, you can benefit from reciprocal attention personally and professionally. I really like this because this is in some ways a beautiful articulation of the hadith that we all know very well, in which the Prophet ﷺ related in a beautiful hadith Qudsi that ana anda dhanni 'abdi bi, right? I am as my abd, as my worshipper, as he or she thinks or conceives of me. And therefore, when we talk about, you know, everybody loves attention, this includes Allah. Allah loves when we pay Him attention. This is something that pleases Allah when we pay Him attention. And when she says, you can benefit from the reciprocal attention, because Allah says, إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي ذَكَرَهُ فِي نَفْسِي, right? When my abd, when my slave, when my worshipper, when he or she mentions me, I mention them. That is what Griffey here is talking about, the reciprocal attention. So if we can, again, go back what we're saying, what? We have this goal of shukr, of gratitude, that we can do in the morning, in the evening. One of the dependencies of this is cultivating attention and paying focus, right? And that when we pay attention to Allah, we get the reciprocal benefit of not of when we mention Him, he mentions us, and as we know, what إذا ذكرني في ملأ أنا ذكرت في ملأ خير منه, right? When he makes mention of me in a group, I make mention of him in a group better than it. So many of us know this hadith, and you can look it up, right? So we also know the beautiful verse in the Quran that we find in Surah Ibrahim, where Allah says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِدَنَّكُمْ. And let's look a little bit at the language here. وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ. And when your Lord, so your Lord, my Lord, when Allah mentioned تَأَذَّنَ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِدَنَّكُمْ, that if you are grateful, I will increase you. Doesn't even say what he will increase us in. And some of the ulama have said it is just في أيزيان, like in any increase, in everything in our life, right? Now Allah says, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنْ, it's been announced, it's been a decree. This is like a royal decree from Allah, to saying that if you are grateful, I mean, this is something that's been broadcast and blasted to all of the seven heavens and earth, right? That if we are grateful to him, that he will increase us. But then he contrasts, and he does this in several places in the Quran, he contrasts shukr with kufr. Now, often we think of, you know, the opposite of kufr or the opposite of disbelief, which can also be understood as hiding the truth. We often see that contrasted with faith, like iman and kufr, belief and disbelief, so to speak, right? But many places in the Quran, Allah contrasts shukr with kufr, and this is one of those verses, wala in kafartum, you know, inna adhabi la shadid. And if you cover up the truth, which is to acknowledge that I am worthy of showing praise and gratitude, if you commit this act of kufr, which is not to acknowledge me, not to pay attention to me, then know that my adab, know that my torment is painful. And about this verse, Sa'adi says in his tafsir, he says, "Ashukru huwa i'tiraful qalbi بِنِعَمِ اللَّهِ وَالثَّنَاءِ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِهَا وَصَرَفَهَا فِي مَرَضَاتِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَكُفْرُ النِّعْمَةِ ضِدُّ ذَلِكَ." He says, when your Lord announced, he says what? That shukr is, it's kind of like, it's something that has to be known in the heart. He uses the verb اعترفه, right? It has to be the word araf, right? This is like an emotional, intellectual intelligence, understanding in the heart, right? It has to be known experientially also. So the word i'tarafa is not only to know, but to know, يعني اعترف بخبر, it's to know something through experience. So Allah is saying that the heart, to really have, for the person to have shukr, your heart has to experientially know bini'amillah, right? The favors that Allah has given you, which requires self-reflection, paying attention. Wathana, right? And therefore, and then praising Allah for this. Wathana ala Allahi biha. And then praising Allah because of these. Wasarafaha fi maradatillahi, right? So this is something that we can really think, and inshallah, reflect upon the importance of it, and being happy, right? And therefore, he says, "Wal kufr ni'amati dhiddu dhalika." Like literally, this is the kufr is the opposite of this. Kufr is not only not recognizing that Allah exists or that He is one, it is also not recognizing that He's worthy of praise. It is also not recognizing that He has bestowed blessings. And we can get caught up very easily in what we don't have. And as we know, the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned in a hadith saying that if he had a valley of gold, he would want two. If he had two, he would want three. We can get very easily caught up into what we don't have. And many of us are living in very difficult situations here at the moment. However, no matter the situation, there is always ni'am, there are always blessings from Allah, if nothing other than the blessing of Islam itself. The ni'am of Allah cannot be measured by some numerical value of what Allah puts in your bank account or the square footage of your home or whatever trinkets that we may have. There are also ethereal aspects, meaning those non-tangible aspects, and Islam is ni'am in itself. It is a blessing in itself. And that is something that the heart needs to i'tiraf al-qalb, right? It needs to do some serious thinking and reflecting upon, you know, what it is that it has. It's also, since he uses the word i'tiraf, right? In order, getting to back to some of the methodologies of shukr, right? Some of the methodologies of shukr are also to confess, to make dhikr, right? We sometimes think that dhikr, I don't know, I don't have a pair here. We think dhikr is the dhikr beads, the what we call the misbahar, the tasbih, or that even it's just subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah. And these are some of the adhkar that we can make. But to have shukr is to acknowledge. And this is going back to the idea of paying attention. If we focus and pay attention, that focus and attention should be directed at the one who is worthy of it, right? One thing that is blameworthy for a person, whether in a religious context or even at work, if you are not paying attention to what you ought to be paying attention to, then you are deficient and you are worthy of ridicule. And as Muslims, this applies to our relationship with Allah just as much as it applies to our, you know, if we're at work and we're on Facebook all day and we're not doing our job and our boss starts, you know, dinging us, we're blameworthy, right? So in the same way, we need to also take it to the level of confessional. And I think that's why if we circle back around, since, you know, we're coming up on about a half an hour, right? Let's circle back around to what were the initial statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Man qala hayna yusbihu Allahumma ma asbaha bi min ni'ma. Right? It's confessional. You wake up in the morning and you confess, you mention, you pay attention, you acknowledge Allah. Ya Allah, any blessing that has come to me, ma asbaha bi min ni'matin from you, or أَوْ بِأَهَدٍ مِّنْ خَلْقِكَ مِنْكَ, or from one of your creation, right? I'm willingly acknowledging this, right? So this helps to give us, hopefully, if we want to end on talking about fulfillment, you know, perhaps we can scratch the fulfillment side, right? When I think of fulfillment, I think of Amazon, like dropping a package off on my porch that somebody could probably steal. There is no fulfillment, right? Let's get this idea, like we will never be fulfilled in this life. It's the nature of dunya, including with our relationship with Allah. Like we will not be fulfilled with our relationship with Allah, because and I want you to understand what I mean by this, in that we have done enough that we can stop. Right, we will never just say, I've done enough dhikr, I've done enough sadaqah, I've done enough ibadah, I've done enough prayers, I've done enough of all of this, I'm good, I'm fulfilled now. I can walk away, like eating. I've eaten my fill, like I can push back. And in fact, you know, like eating, you can eat to the point that you're like stuffed. Eventually, which, you know, hopefully we don't do too much, right? But even eventually, even if you eat to the point that you're stuffed, your body will consume that, apply that nutrition, and then what? It's going to need more, right? So maybe we just daily gratitude and spiritual focus, daily gratitude and spiritual attentiveness. These might be perhaps some, you know, better words to help define and articulate what this will, you know, what this will mean for us. So inshallah, I hope that these things will help you on your journey, inshallah, back to Allah, and that He will make you from amongst those that He will be pleased with. Just another anecdote, kind of before we go, and then I and to share one last verse, right? There is this 2006 survey by the University of Chicago, and they were surveying golfers, right? And they split them up into two groups, the professional pro golfers and the novice golfers. Here's the interesting thing, getting again to a little bit more insight on focus, right, and attentiveness. They found that when they attached these electrodes to the brains of professional pro golfers, right, or at least expert golfers, they found that when it came to golfing, their brains actually exhibited less brain activity than the novice, right? And this shows that, you know, once you reach a level of competence, right, when you have focus, you're more relaxed. You're actually more relaxed. It's the novice who has a, you know, it's like, that's me. I can barely even hit the golf ball, right? Your brain is going bonkers because it takes so much to get it under control, right? So in our journey into cultivating daily gratitude and spiritual attentiveness, right, understand in the beginning it may be very hard because you're having to employ every single muscle to the exercise, including maybe some that you shouldn't, right? Like with the pro golfer, you know, they look like their swing is so effortless. Mine does not. I don't have a golf swing. I look like I'm swinging a chainsaw or something, right? And that's because I'm probably employing not only all the muscles, but too many muscles, right? So when you really become proficient, which is something that takes time, right? Over time, and you practice, become better at this, you will find that tranquility and that ease, which leads me really up into just the last, I want to share one last verse, which many of us know, right? Many of us are familiar with this verse that we find in Surah Ra'd, right? And what's interesting about this verse, now we know that many people, when I read this to you, many people know this verse, because you'll find it in calligraphy, you'll find it everywhere, you'll find it all over in these places. But people don't really often know the verse that comes before, right? So in this verse in Surah Ra'd, we know the famous verse, أَلَّذِينَ آمُنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَلَى بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ, right? Those that have iman, those that have faith, right? And whose hearts find remembrance in the peace of in the remembrance of Allah. It's actually an interesting statement. It starts with Alladina amanu, those who believe. It's as if it's picking up the conversation from somewhere else. But we read it like it's kind of poetry. Alladina amanu wa tatma'innu qulubuhum bi dhikrillahi ala, right? This is a balagha, a rhetorical question. Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innu qulub, right? Our hearts not put in a state of tranquility and rest by the remembrance of Allah. But if we look at the verse that comes before it, which is very important to understand contextually, Allah says, what? وَيَقُولَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْ أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ. Those who are kafir, right? Those who are disbelievers, those that cover the truth or don't want to acknowledge it, they say, why hasn't a sign come to Muhammad from his Lord? Alayhi salatu wasalam, qul, Allah instructs him, say, in Allah yudillu man yasha'u wa yahdi ilayhi man anaba. Say to them that Allah will misguide whomever He wants, and He will guide to him the kind of person that is what? Munib, the one that does anaba. The verb anaba means to turn around, to come back to frequently. So going to one of the very first things that we mentioned. What? Pay attention, because when you pay attention, you get the benefit of reciprocal attention. When we turn to Allah, even if it's in repentance, and actually this is what the verb anaba implies, it doesn't mean they just turn to Allah, they also turn and repent. I mean, they've done things that are wrong, but they're still believers, meaning we're not perfect, right? They turn to Allah, and then that person that turns to Allah, even if they are a sinner, they are called alladhina amanu. They are called those who believe. They are called those people of faith. And even if they are people that sin and commit mistakes, Allah attestifies that they are believers. And that's why, وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, their hearts are brought to rest by Allah. So even when, right, this goes, when we give gratitude, when we pay attention, we get the reciprocal benefit of Allah, then what? Paying attention to us, forgiving us for our sins, and then we have an actual relationship with Him. We have the i'tiraf al-qalb, we have an experiential, a confessional, out loud relationship with Allah that we will feel in our heart. And that's why Allah says, "Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innu al-qulub," our hearts not brought to rest and given ease by His remembrance. So turn to Him and establish your relationship with Him. Pay attention in the morning and the night. Acknowledge the blessings that come to Him, whether directly or through anything else in His creation, and do so again in the evening. And inshallah, if you and I can do that, then we will, by the words of His beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, be amongst those who have fulfilled their daily obligation for shukr, inshallah. So I ask Allah Ta'ala to bless you and your families during this time, to keep you close to Him, to forgive you and pardon you of any of your mistakes, and to make you, inshallah, of the murtadeen, inshallah, those that He has pleased with, and especially min ash-shakirin. May Allah Ta'ala make you from amongst the people of shukr. Wa jazakum Allahu khayran. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.